Hello everyone, and welcome to this fifth Maersk webinar on our decarbonization journey. I've been hosting four of these until now, where I've invited different experts from across Maersk to come and talk a bit more into the details of our decarbonization journey. And this time it is mostly going to be around ships, about our new large carbon neutral vessels. So therefore with me today I have two of my technical colleagues. I have Emiliano Austi, who is head of the Naval architecture team, so the engineers who have been doing the overall design of these new wonderful vessels that we shall soon see a movie of. I also have with me Ole Graa Jakobsen, whom has, I think it's your third time you are starring here in the in the webinars.
Yes.
But Ole is heading up our fleet technology team, so the overall group of engineers that we have. So I'll get back to the two gentlemen later on, and as mentioned, we will even show a video of the new vessels. But before we dive into that, it's been a while since we had our last webinar, so I'll just give a few reflections. A lot has happened. Among other things, we have had the COP26, and I had the pleasure of representing our company there in Glasgow. And I think overall that was a rather encouraging experience in the sense that there was a lot of lean-in and engagement from the private sector. A lot of companies making commitments, and I think in our world of logistics, very importantly, a lot of demand signals being placed out there. One example, this was actually a few weeks before the COP26, but we saw the launch of the so-called cargo owners for zero emission vessels, which are eight large shippers who are committing to only buying zero emission shipping in 2040. Another one is the so-called First Mover Coalition, where we actually, as Maersk, we are a founding member. But there are more than 30 companies who have signed up for this coalition. And in there is a commitment to buy 10% of the shipping in 2030 as zero emission shipping. So some very important demand signals being put out there by our customers. So that is very encouraging, and that will get the ball rolling even faster. From the regulatory side, we saw the Clyde Bank's announcement for green corridors. So commitments from companies and countries to establish, you can say, the boundary conditions for establishing infrastructure and regulatory regimes for doing green shipping corridors. So also very encouraging. What was not so encouraging was then that after the COP, the IMO gathered and really failed to step up to the challenge. We didn't get a price on carbon. We didn't get an increased ambition for 2050. So very, very disappointing. But and I think that disappointment is actually shared widely in the shipping community. But it will not hold us back at all. And I think that, I guess, is the perfect segue over to you, Ole, to talk about these new vessels that we're putting out in 2024.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. And been looking so much forward to actually being able to show the design of these vessels, because they've not only been designed for being carbon neutral, they have also been designed so that they are more efficient than other vessels.
They sure look nice, but I guess you didn't just design them to look nice, did you?
Oh, no, it doesn't matter. It's of course great that they look nice, but the primary focus have been on making sure that they were efficient here. And what we managed to do is that these vessels will be 20% more efficient than the average container vessel on the same size. And what we actually also have achieved is to make the energy consumption per container moved as low as it is on our 20K vessels that the triplets that we designed for some years ago. So, and because they'll be running on carbon neutral fuel, they will be, you say, displacing 1 million tons of CO2 in our network per year when they are all eight deployed on methanol. So, Emiliano, let's talk more about the details, let's focus in on some of the features.
Of course, here the goal was to create a compact vessel, efficient, carbon neutral, that could also be very flexible in our deployment and thereby also serving better our customers. So that was the key objective. But we can look a little bit more into the design features now into the video. So the first step was moving the accommodation completely forward, making more space for container. And namely, we have been able to increase the container capacity by 7% when you compare it to our Hong Kong class, and while also making the vessel a little bit shorter. The vessel has been equipped with the dual fuel engines, both auxiliary engines and main engines. And we have also a 16,000 cubic meter methanol tank that has been placed just forward of the engine room. The exhaust has been routed aft to the port side into the funnel. And there in the footprint of the funnel, we also managed to squeeze further containers. When you look it now from the starboard side, normally the side where we go alongside, you have a full availability for the containers, for the cranes to operate, and that thereby also increased considerably the port efficiency. And here is the lineup of all the 8 vessels.
Yeah, super. Looks very nice. And just be completely honest, I've seen some small feeder vessels in the past where they had the accommodation for the forward and the funnel aft. So it's not a completely new design, but I presume the new thing is to do it in a vessel of this size. So has that been a super easy task for your team?
Not really. We have been working for about 5 years into this. We have been working mainly on the concept design in the first part, internally with our technical team. And then also together with ABS and DMA, we have been working on mainly making sure that the structural part is sound and proof when you move the accommodation forward, and then also compliance with the rules and regulations. Mm. That has been the first step for us.
Okay, so which challenges have there been? Could we talk more about those challenges that you have been there to solve?
Yeah. Of course. We have been having a few challenges. The first part for us, one of the key design parameters is the crew comfort. We have been doing a lot of analysis and calculations around that. Thereby, we have been finding quite good solutions, both on the design side, structural side of the accommodation, make it on par to comparable vessels. Then the next step was looking into the acceleration and forces. When the vessel is pitching into water, then you have, of course, additional forces acting on the crew. And there we have been working quite a lot on the bow part, in the forward part of the ship, to make it less prone to that accelerations.
Yeah, super. And I have to say that this about that we are designing the vessel so that the crew is feeling that they are, you say, do have the similar feeling as being on other vessels, that has been very, very important for us in this. And we have also done a lot of effort. We have also made additional insulation on the noise insulation at the accommodation, because we also are living very close to the different mooring arrangements there. So Emiliano, I guess you have spent these five years on solving more than one challenge. So
yes.
So what else?
Of course, one of the main part of our evaluation has been around the torsional strength. So when you move the accommodation completely forward, then you have a cargo hold that is like an open shoebox that is subject to forces. And there we have been working and looking at solutions. And the main solution has been on the structural arrangement. We found that to be sound and proof with all the implemented solution we had. We had also a couple of other challenges for which we found a very good solution. One was a navigation light arrangement, and then the lifeboat arrangement. That's also was quite good. And the last part, of course, when you look at a ship with the accommodation completely forward, like on cruise vessels, the captain and the crew have a different feeling of the vessel course and turn. There we have included extra cameras, and then we will do further training for our crew and crew personnel.
Okay, great. That looks good. So, but it's not only in order to make these new features that we have been working. We have also worked hard to actually design these vessels for being propelled by methanol as the first larger container vessels. And we've followed the interim guidelines that are in place already. But we also made some improvements relative to that. We've been working with MAN in order to ensure that we have an engine that is sufficiently large that can be running on methanol in order to you could say, give the vessel the power that it needs. We've been working with the Hyundai's engine manufacturer Himsen for the 4-stroke engines that we need for the for the auxiliary engines. These vessels are dual fuel and traditionally dual fuel vessels have had LNG as the second fuel. We have methanol. It's much easier to handle because methanol is a liquid in normal state, and the biggest challenge is that they have that we do that they have a higher, you say, a lower flash point. So we need to make sure that all pipes are double wall pipes, and there's say additional cover dams to make sure that no single failure can expose non-hazardous areas for the methanol. But I think we have managed that already, and we're now ready to go into the detailed design of these vessels.
That's great. Thanks, Ole and Emiliano. This is surely these vessels are a big milestone for us. And again, you can say they are only 8 out of 740. But actually, I think you mentioned it, Ole, when all these 8 vessels are out sailing on green methanol and we have phased out smaller, older vessels, then we will actually be have abated a million tons of CO2 every year. So a very, very, very significant first step in our journey.
Yeah, definitely. The vessels are, as I said, designed to run also on standard fuel. But in order to achieve these savings, we need to have them running on methanol, carbon neutral methanol. So we need some methanol, Morten. How are we doing on that?
Yeah, I know. I think we knew all along that that would be the most difficult part. 2024 is still a challenge. It's not going to be easy. We still believe we will have some fuel in 2024, some green fuels. Will we have all the fuel for all the maiden voyages of all the ships? That we cannot guarantee. But already in 25, certainly in 26, actually the supply pipeline looks a lot better. So I would say that we will get these ships up and running on green methanol. And I'm still optimistic it will be in 2024. But we have not yet signed any contracts, but have some very good and strong dialogues with very serious partners. So we're optimistic, and that certainly shouldn't be holding you guys back from keeping innovating.
No, I think we'll be continuing. And if you look in the history, we've been breaking boundaries a couple of times in the history. We've been building the world's largest container vessel several times. And for ship nerds, we can just mention the Emma class and the 20K, the triple E's first ones. And the reason we can do this is because it's been a focus for Maersk to have a strong technical team. And we're working very close with our teams that are operating the vessel and having good feedback loops to the crew on board the vessel, meaning that every time we are designing a vessel, we can make it a little bit better than the previous vessels we did. And then we're focusing a lot on innovation. So we do actually have a number of innovation projects in the pipeline. So this will definitely not be the last innovation that we'll bring at the vessels.
Keep it up, both the innovation and the great teamwork and collaboration. And with that, I want to thank you very much for taking the time here. And thank you everyone for listening in, and have a great day.